2018 Chapter of Excellence Showcase. My name is Rachel Shelburne, and I'm one of the two Fraternal Excellence Initiative coordinators at SUNY Plattsburgh. I would like to introduce our reviewers for today. We have Christina Vega, the Assistant Director of Fraternity and Sorority Life at the University of Vermont, Vinicus B. Vargas, Coordinator of Fraternity and Sorority Life at the University of Vermont, and Brandon Comodara, Graduate Assistant Advisor at the University of Vermont for Fraternity and Sorority Life. And from our campus at SUNY Plattsburgh, just for support, is William Cangelosi, our Graduate Advisor, and Alison Swigden, our Director of Fraternity and Sorority Life, and Kelsey Henn, who is the next Fraternal Excellence Initiative Coordinator for the 2018. I'd like now to introduce our second group of the day, Samantha Hogan.
Hello guys, I'm Mike. I got in spring 16. I'm the former philanthropy chair, former director of member and community engagement, and I'm currently serving as president.
Hey again guys, I'm Mike O'Donnell. I got in fall 2015. I'm the former director of recruitment, and I'm the current judicial chair.
Morning, I'm Jake. I am former president and former director of finance operations, and I got in the fall 2015.
Good morning, I'm Rafael Santana, and I'm actually currently a new member of Spring 18.
How you guys doing? I'm Jake Bed, current director of education and wellness, former recruitment chair, former community service chair, and I want to come out.
Alright, so Sigma Tau Gamma in the past couple of years have obviously went through a lot of changes, both locally and nationally. One of our biggest changes nationally was our mission statement. Our new mission statement is, we strive to build noble generations of men who always endeavor forward. And after winning Chapter of Excellence last year, we wanted to endeavor forward. So we did not just go average and take the Chapter of Excellence and just not do anything after. We really wanted to increase what we did this year. And we lived up to this mission statement, everyday actions of our brothers in this chapter. So for growth and development, we feel that growth and development are some of the most important parts of being a member of Sigma Tau Gamma. We really focus on these five things. Academics, we always have academic plans for our brothers that always need it. We try to be very responsible when we're out in a social setting. We try to give emotional support as much as possible to any brother that needs it. Physical, always having brothers in the gym together, trying to get bigger together. And leadership, we always try to develop leaders in our chapter through mentorships and other things like that. And our local motto is not without my brothers, because we're always there, we're in each other's hands. So in the past year, we've changed a lot. This quote we stand on, change is inevitable, however change can be good, and change is whatever we make of it. So we've changed in very positive ways. A couple examples are better academic plans, reworking our risk management policies, working with various campus offices to put together workshops to improve our organization, putting on events with other organizations to improve interfraternal relations, better community service and philanthropic opportunities, definitely better recruitment, and we implemented no pay, no go, which is, we had a problem with debt the past, as long as I've been in, so, no pay, no go is a system that if you do not pay your dues fully, you cannot go to anything, any social functions, any chapter, anything. So we feel these changes have led to the improvements we have made in the past year, and we continue to strive to make ourselves better through these actions.
On top of that, we also encourage our brothers to join an on-campus club or organization, or get a job on campus in order to, you know, keep us involved, get our name out there. Also, every week, brothers are required to attend a event or presentation of another club, fraternity or sorority, or participate in some sort of community service event. If they fail to do this, then they will be banned from the house that weekend, which includes all socials, all sober hangouts, all sorts of events at the house, anything like that they cannot go to. three of these events, these weekly events that they are required to go to, every semester have to be career or future related to make sure that, that our brothers are, you know, getting prepared for that life after college. Also, as far as community service goes, every brother, by our constitution now, which is the change that we have made, is they are required to complete 20 hours of community service or be sent to our standards board to either be banned from social functions or then made to do more community service in order to ensure that, that we keep the same level of excellence, if not improve. Some of our clubs and organizations that our brothers are part of is the Cross Team, the Fraternity Council, Fraternities and Missouri Life Office, the Marketing Club, Ski and Snowboard Club, Carmen Points, Fitness Center or Personal Training, Student Ambassador Programs, Residence Life, Teachers Assistants, Jiu-Jitsu Club, Summer Orientation Staff, and the Student Association Judicial Court.
So yeah, going into academics. Last semester, we had the highest fraternal GPA with 2.9. Not that great, still something we want to improve on, but it was the best out of all fraternities on campus. That's going from spring 2017 to fall 2017, we had a 2.9 and a 2.93 respectively. So going into our standards thing, I have high standards background, being past vice president standards for the fraternity council. So we like to adopt the Big Four to our own, kind of amend it to our own constitution, our own standards. So one of the biggest Big Four policies we have at the school is if you break the rules, expect the consequences. We run a tight ship with our own organization the same way. Positive and negative reinforcement. We like to give out awards to certain brothers for doing great things each semester. We have highest GPA, the President's Award, which is anybody that receives over a 3.5. We have the Roskin Scholar Award, which is anybody that receives over a 3.0. I already said highest GPA, highest new member GPA, most improved. One of the biggest improvements we saw last semester was we saw a brother go from a 2.4, which in our own organization is considered inactive, to a 3.3, I believe it was, in one semester. So we were very, very happy with that. We also had the lead red and whiteboard. We had to change that. That goes to the brother that just like shows the best principles that we live by every single day. We have the highest community service award, and the brother who has the most. One thing we really pride ourselves on is working with Chief of University Police for two different things. We went to a presentation on gang violence in the community. We had a problem with that the past few semesters. We had, I believe, 80% of our chapter attend that workshop in about an hour, hour and a half long. As well as we had them come into our own personal chapter and give a presentation on the dangers of drugs and other substances in our community. So yeah, risk management, we take it very seriously. This is not something we mess around with, especially myself being the current standards board like advisor for our fraternity. We go above and beyond the campus risk management policy. As I said, we like to work with UP every semester, try to get something together to better ourselves, better our Greenlight community. We put many new changes into effect. We've taken a very big stand on punishments. We don't want to get our own brothers in trouble for stuff that they do. So we have very negative reinforcements, like banning them from the house, banning them from social functions, just making them better themselves, bringing all the negative energy around us. So we make sure to follow all the rules on the campus, city, and national organization.
So our two philanthropies are our National Philanthropy, which is Special Olympics New York, and our local philanthropy, which is Journey Into Reading. Every spring semester, all of our money that we raise goes to our Journey Into Reading, and in the fall, we benefit the Special Olympics New York through their Polar Plunge, where each brother is assigned to raise at least $100 from family, friends, and donate that to Special Olympics. So in spring 17, we had a very low philanthropy number of $8.73 per member. That was because of my personal shortcomings and not handing in philanthropy reports on time. But since then, My brothers actually got on me and then challenged me to, you know, be better, be more organized, and hand in those reports actually on time. So since then, as the numbers show, which in fall 17 and so far in spring 18, we've raised $170 per member, because not only was I challenged to hang in everything on time and then become more organized, which then better me as a person, I was then motivated to then pass that down to those who come after me. So we've raised over $6,000 total in the past year between Special Olympics and Journey into Reading. And those are our two philanthropies right there. So we also, you know, like to give back to our community, because we know that that's one of the reasons why we're here on this campus. We take a lot of pride in it. We do community service at places like Journey into Reading, where we read to children, or they just, you know, help them organize, help them sell books. We work at the field house with the classroom baseball team, setting the field, shagging fly balls. Special Olympics New York, every year we get a pole plunge, we help them promote, help them set up, help them do parking, sell merchandise. We also work with soup kitchen at the Trinity Church every Wednesday, as well as Clinton Dining Hall, helping them set up, more SPCA, Walking Dogs, the public library, stocking shelves, carrying around boxes, CDPH to go and do a community service inside of the hospital, Project Help, Really for Life, whether that's set up, take down, or just working the event in general, as well as working lacrosse clinics with children. We also take our interfraternal relations very seriously. So we have many of our social programs, which include Greek Week meet and greet with Phi Alpha Lambda, homecoming with Alpha Phi, and different events like the NSGD awareness event, CDPI, one with CDPI to promote diversity, and different events with Title IX and JWI.
Thank you. So we're
going to
move on to our
attendance
and questioning now.
Yeah,
will you all talk to us about your member education
program?
Yeah.
Sorry.
I struggled with that. So year 2017, we kind of switched things up a little bit. We added some new rush events to get guys that we wanted to go for more quality people, over quantity. So one of the events that I personally found at a leadership conference out at Kansas City, called the Sigtong Experience. It's literally just the guys come around, put them into groups, and we have them go to group of brothers, and literally just every aspect of preparing, from paying dues to what the executive cabinet does. We have them learn all about that before they even accept the bid. So in the year 2017, we had a 95% acceptance rate. It was literally just one person, and he fit better somewhere else, which we encourage wholeheartedly. So with the new member education, we had them meet with the new member educators weekly, and we had them submit their grades to the new member educators along with our advisor and our deputy cabinet. And also another thing we implemented that we've done before but hasn't always worked out is having them meet with other organizations' new members. We feel that is a great way for them to get their foot in the door in Greek life as a whole, because obviously that's what we're all here for. And overall, we had 18 new members in the year 2017.
Can you tell us a little bit about how you navigate attendance at City Plattsburgh Training Service Programming as well as your National Organizations Programming?
Yeah, so I can go into that. So that was kind of like what we went in with. If you don't go to an event for the week, you're not allowed to the house the next week. Weekend, excuse me. So at the beginning of every chapter, we do this thing called roll call. We take down the classes missed for our brothers, the community service hours for our brothers, and the event that they had for the week. So if you don't have an event for the week, you're not allowed to come to the house. That's for like a brotherhood social event, sober hangouts. I remember a case a couple years ago where one of my brothers actually lived in the house, didn't have a event for the week, so he just locked himself in his room, kind of grounded himself. So we take it very seriously. We want you to spread your knowledge, go to other people's events, support them, support our own events.
So yeah, we definitely take that very seriously, like events and all that jazz.
Can you talk about the National a little bit?
Yeah, sure.
So we, every year we have the Web Academy, which the executive board goes to, and then we have the Grand Chapter. So the Grand Chapter is more of a, it's more of a fun hangout, but you're always required at least 4 people to go. And we had 4 people, I went, and then for Web Academy, we never missed one. So we always in attendance and always in full. We've never been late.
So earlier you referenced your financial management piece of a work in progress. You talked about some changes that you all made in terms of the paid-in bill. Can you talk a little bit about what that change actually has looked like in terms of balancing that budget?
Yes. So because that was one of our glaring issues was how much debt that bill you were in for Nationals. So we decided to first put all the brothers who already had an outstanding debt. Whether it be very significant or not that much, on different payment plans, and then spread it up, and our finance guy went through and put it up into different percentiles, and then let them know how much they had to pay and what sort of increments, so that we can work that down. And then that was just from the time that our newer class was getting in, so we decided to start no pay no go. Very strictly with our newer class to not only implement that culture of, hey guys, you have to pay your dues, but to also carry that on for the coming generations. So this way, with our outstanding debt, we can chop that down while not building any from the bottom.
Can I go off that?
Yeah.
So one thing we've also done this semester, unfortunately it doesn't really count here, but it's definitely something we're working on. So as of right now, at this moment in time, with the new class just getting in, we did no pay, no go for them for this semester. And we did by the percentile. So if you don't pay off a certain percentage of depending on your debt, you're not allowed at the house for the rest of the semester. So basically, no pay, no go until you pay off that one chunk. And then starting the first day of classes next semester, if you don't have an outstanding balance of zero, you're not allowed to come back. So we're definitely putting our foot down with that because we need to. And like all the perks that we get from actually paying our dues is like something that we would like to enjoy and take.
So you talked a little bit about the new mission statement change. Can you talk a little bit about how you are educating your members in terms of adopting that and having things like that?
Can you repeat the question?
Yeah, so you started off talking about the new mission statement for the organization. So can you talk a little bit about how you're educating members in terms of this change and updating those changes and that everyone's on the same page?
So with that new mission statement and with this new rebranding, we got new books for our new member process, and they're called Path of Principles books. National sends that along with all the associate member pins badges to us earlier in the semester. So we make sure that that our new member educator and our assistant new member educator are completely knowledgeable about the Path of Principles book. So this way they can not only give our new members the Path of Principles book, which has our mission statement, all of our new values, our new principles, but not to only give it to them, but to be able to properly educate them because they were taught by brothers who went to those national conventions.
Can you tell me a little bit about your relationship with different faculty and staff on campus?
Yes. As far as different faculty and staff go, we work very closely with Dr. Ray Carman, who's our advisor, who, let's say, it's like a brother is struggling in like a certain class, or it's like a certain part of the schoolwork, whether that's time management, or has to learn how to study, or finding a tutor. We always send them to Dr. Rick Carman, and he's always super helpful, always helps them set themselves up with tutors, helps them get themselves more organized, as well as just getting on that right track to get those grades up.
We've also done a lot of work with CDPI and the head of CDPI, who is Dr. J.W. Wiley, who's also a professor here. We've done numerous events on Title IX. We have a very good relationship with Allison Swick. We've had three past members serve on the fraternity council, so we've always been with her and Will Candelosi. Definitely missing something here, something that we do.
Yeah, I was just going to say, when I was president, we really fostered a relationship with Dr. J.W. Wiley. We co-sponsored an event with CDPI. We had to come to our chapter twice. just to, because we became a very diverse group in the past couple years, so we want to make sure that all of our brothers understand what diversity is, and make sure that there's no problems within the chapter because of the how diverse we become.
And we actually have one of our alumni who works in the academic advising office, so we always we encourage brothers to go see him, even just to spark up a conversation. Maybe he can point you in the right direction, get some help. So yeah, we definitely take advantage of our faculty and like connections to our students.
Is there anything else that maybe, obviously your short presentation that you didn't get to cover that you want to very quickly go over?
Yes. Last semester in fall 2017, we had the lowest new member GPA with, I believe, a 2.26. So being that our most glaring problem, we decided to fix it. So with this most recent new class, we made changes such as having them meet with Dr. Ray Carmen for any of those struggling grades, as well as have them submit weekly reports on their grades to make sure that they weren't being overwhelmed by the new member process. We also had them make a master schedule of all their assignments and tests to make sure that we weren't having new member education class like the day before like someone's big test or some big assignment, to make sure that we weren't putting too much pressure on them and that they could work at like their own pace to keep those grades up.
Something they also implemented and suggested were library hours, and was something I highly enjoyed because we met about like two times a week as a new class, and it was awesome because all the brothers came and helped us out with like all academically. Me and Mr. Wu were in the same education program, so he helped me type papers and stuff along those lines and format certain things since he is ahead of me in the major. So it made us bond closer together as brotherhood and stuff along those lines. That's something that I love, that they made us strive for greatness with academically, which is huge to me. So it was awesome.
And then on Sunday at the
University of
Pitt, we will be